What are the threats that the human body faces, and are my defense capabilities at their best to be able to thwart any of those, right? Mm. And at the end of the day, the health of ourselves, the way the communication between across the body happens, and the strength or the status of the defense mechanism are all dependent on choices that we make.
Welcome to a brand new episode of the Startup Operator Podcast. I'm your host, Roshan Karyappa. Our guest today is Vivek Subramaniam, who is the co-founder and CEO of AltLife, which is helping people fight and overcome lifestyle diseases. Vivek is a serial entrepreneur. He was formerly the CEO of Fintellix, a banking compliance and risk analytics company. We have a lot to talk about in this podcast with Vivek, so let's get started. This episode is brought to you by Moolia. You want to move fast? Sure. But without breaking things? Now that's a hard ask. The thing is, once you have some base of users and customers, you just cannot afford to risk quality. So how do the likes of Cred, Swiggy, and CureFit, you know, some of India's fastest growing startups, ship at lightning pace and delight their users and customers? Simple, they're working with Moolia as a strategic quality partner. Moolia is India's most talented and passionate community of testers. They've helped prevent thousands of bugs and regression issues. So as a CTO or a product owner, if you want to reduce tech debt, especially while you scale, do check out Moolia.com. I've interviewed Moolia's founder and CEO Pradeep on the podcast earlier, and we spoke about how startups can improve quality while scaling and things to that effect. You should definitely check it out. I'll link to it in the description below. Now back to your regular programming. Started. Welcome, Vivek. Thank you so much for making the time.
Roshan, happy to be here. Thank you for having me.
Wonderful. So Vivek, how did you get started with AltLife? And maybe, you know, you could talk about your background leading to that also.
Sure. So, you know, obviously, this is more about Live AltLife. So won't go delve too much into the Fintellix story. But in a nutshell, it all started in Fintellix in a way, right? So that, like you said, was a banking risk compliance product company, you know, funded by IDG Sequoia, exited to NASDAQ, listed Verisk Analytics in 2017. I exited from the combined entity after the integration was done towards the end of 2018. And that's when Live AltLife journey started.
Okay.
But the reason Live AltLife started was, you know, through choices I made in my life and, you know, starting with iCreate, which then became Fintellix, et cetera. Around 10, 12 years back, I got diagnosed as being pre-diabetic, right? And then, spoke to a doctor, what should be done, et cetera. In a couple of years, that became full-blown diabetes. And, you know, I was on medication. Every couple of years, you know, the medication doses would keep increasing, et cetera. I felt fine. I feel fine. However, my lab reports were telling a different story. And what I'd heard was that, you know, diabetes is a chronic and progressive disease, which means once you get it, it doesn't go away. And over time, it keeps becoming worse. I didn't question it. I just went with, you know, the advice I got and kept popping pills and trying to make the right choices, through the journey. However, the first time I got an opportunity to reflect and think was after I got out, right? And as I was thinking, what next? And I realized that I wanted to do entrepreneurship again. And, you know, I took a view that as long as my body and mind are working well, I'll keep solving problems. I enjoy doing that. And then the question was, you know, from the mid-30s to the mid-40s, I've come, right? In a way, relatively unscathed, other than if you look inside the body. But as I'm conjuring up the next startup, it'll take 8-10 years to meaningfully build it out. Will I be healthy enough, right? So far, you know, I feel good. But obviously, my doctor tells me that, you know, I need to take care. My medicines are increasing. So that was a question playing on my mind. And eventually, you know, two things I was thinking about come end of 18. One was, how do I remain healthy? Second was, what problem do I solve for, right? And, you know, that took me down a path of, you know, a lot of research, reading, kind of a quasi pseudo course in medicine where I did physiology and biochemistry and microbiology and understanding how the body works, because the core question I wanted to answer, Roshan, was I was fine and then parts of me were not fine. It wasn't a pathogen, it wasn't like a virus or a bacteria. What went wrong? Why did it go wrong? Why is my body not behaving the same way as somebody else, etc.? And to find the answer to that was where this entire journey kind of went in. And obviously, with the insights I had, there was a convergence of the two paths. One, what business should we build? And secondly, how do I remain healthy? And the answer ended up becoming Live Old Life, right? And obviously, I'll get into the details of that in a bit, but that's the broad story, right, of introduction and how Live Old Life started, right?
Right. Yeah, it's a very important problem that you're trying to solve for, right? Because I remember reading this line in a book by this guy, Bill Bryson, who's one of my favorite authors, actually. He wrote this book called The Body. And in that, he has this line which says something like, for the first time, more people globally are dying from non-communicable diseases than all of the infectious diseases combined. It's crazy if you think about it. We're living in an age where more people are killed by lifestyle than anything else.
No, without a doubt. And, that's where part of the convergence happened, because otherwise it was an individual war, right? Mm-hmm. For me, and how do I become healthy? Mm-hmm. But along the way, when I looked at the stats, Roshan, it's scary. I didn't realize the scale of the problem. And, my sister is a doctor, and obviously she helped direct me to some of the literature. She's also an epidemiologist. Mm-hmm. And that's where I looked at some of the data as well. Mm-hmm. You will realize that, what you said is absolutely right, which is the number overwhelms every other cause of death, right? And if you were to quantify that, it is for a population of about 1.3 billion that India is, we're talking anywhere between 200 to 300 million people that have the problem now, right? And half of them don't know about it, right? That's the unfortunate part of some of these diseases. Second, in the world of 7 billion people, about 1 billion have the problem, and it's hurtling towards 2 billion over the next two decades.
Wow.
Right? So it's a massive sized problem, right? Mm. Third, the age at which it is impacting people, what used to be in the 60s and 70s, has now come down to 20s and 30s. And, in those rare exceptions, in the teens as well. Like we talk about juvenile obesity, juvenile diabetes, etc. So that's the third problem. So A, it is growing at a massive clip. B, it is a significant chunk of the world's population. Mm. And C, it is impacting people at younger and younger ages. And right. and that's the scary part about this problem.
Right. But healthcare is also one of those domains that suffers from the expert problem, right? I mean, Vinod Khosla has this quote that, nothing is ever disrupted or reinvented by the experts.
Yeah.
Because they're too close to the problem. They've studied everything that is prevalent right now in so much detail that they cannot think from an alternate perspective. So, right. With your venture as such, how do you reinvent some of these presuppositions?
No, and I think that's a great point, you make and Vinod Khosla makes, etc. Because, as I was thinking about it, an individual lens, right? And as I was uncovering some of the science, some of the research, some of the workings of the human body, etc. You realize that, for me, my body is one, my mind is one, and I'm one, right? But there are so many things that play a role. That, if it is my pancreas and, liver, I need to go to an endocrinologist or a diabetologist, right? If it is stress, right, which also has a direct bearing, I need to go to a counselor, a psychologist, right? If it is what I eat that is causing me the problem, right, then I need to go to a nutritionist, right? If I have some muscles that are not working well that need to be strengthened, made more flexible, I need to go to a physiotherapist, right? Now, each one of them, and the way I thought about it is, it's like that elephant and, different blind men and what they feel of it and they talk about it, and it's me, my mind, my body, and my health. But each one knows their piece really well, right? They're the depth guys. But nobody's taking a single view of who am I, what are the issues I have, and what is the right way for me to solve it. And that is where I felt, you know, neither am I a doctor, right? Nor have I, you know, been solving this problem all this while. But I felt I was in a unique position because I'm a person that needs to solve it for myself and for a whole lot of others. And we need to take up, you know, consumer-centric, or in this case, it's a patient-centric view. Every one of these multiple disciplines need to come together to be able to solve, because that's the problem, right? Because, you know, if I were to go deeper, and I don't want to bore, you know, your audience with minutiae of, you know, cellular health and, you know, hormonal communication system and et cetera, but at a very high level, Roshan, it all boils down to three things. One, we are made up of cells at a unit level, and those cells work together. You know, they form tissues and organs and the entire body, et cetera. Are they functioning well, right? If each one of them does their function well, that's one, clear requirement to stay healthy. Second, you need them to communicate well with other people, other cells, other organs, because each one plays a specialized role, right? And each has to work in conjunction with the other. And third, what are the threats that the human body faces, and are my defense capabilities at their best to be able to thwart any of those, right? Mm. And at the end of the day, the health of ourselves, the way the communication between across the body happens, and the strength or the status of the defense mechanism are all dependent on choices that we make, right? And at the outset, let me say, you know, as a diabetic, the medicines that I eat don't fix any of these, right? Which is why I never get better when I have those medicines. Those medicines help manage the symptom, right? And which is why over time, their ability to manage keeps going down and my condition keeps getting worse, right? If you want to really solve for it, you need to understand what is the root cause, right? At the, most minute level, there is something that's not working. Can you make it work, yeah, right? And, the communication system across cells, there are two. One is your chemical communication system, which is more hormonal. And then there is your electrical system, which is more neural, right? And, you know, if you think about a house, we have to make a choice of bricks, we have to make a choice of cement, we have to make a choice of wood, etc. We make the right choice, we build a strong structure, right? We make a suboptimal choice and we say use hollow bricks or rotten wood, etc. We will end up with a structure. It looks like a house, right? But it's very vulnerable, right? Same thing with the body. If we don't provide the right material for all of this to function well, it will not, right? And that's what results in any one of these lifestyle diseases, right? Because, you know, obviously your cells are made up of something called as a bilipid membrane, your mitochondria, your nucleus, all of it has it. That needs certain materials for it to function well, right? If it doesn't, there's stuff that goes in your cell that shouldn't go in, there's stuff that comes out which shouldn't come out. You know, your energy production is polluting, right? Just like you put wrong fuel into a car, right? Obviously, you'll have fumes and pollutants that come out. Similarly, if you don't put the right fuel in, you know, you will, and the pollutants within are, one example is something called as reactive oxygen species, or O minus ion, right? And that goes and reacts and causes a process called inflammation. But essentially, you need to fix your cells and make sure they function well. You need to ensure that your metabolic balance is intact and the integrity is maintained, and you need to strengthen your body's defense mechanisms, right? And then as you looked at these, and these are the only way you can attack it at the root cause level and actually fix the problem. Mm. Now, it all comes down to choices we make every day multiple times. What is it that we eat? When do we eat, right? What's our view on fitness and exercise? Right? Do we sleep well? Is there stress that we face on a chronic basis, etc.? What we don't understand is the implication of these choices, and that's what part of what I've uncovered through the process. Because 50 to 60% of the problem is based on nutrition. And please remember the brick and cement example. Shouldn't we build our body with the right structures, right? With the right input, And if you don't eat the right kind of, I mean, there's something called macronutrients, there's something called micronutrients, which is your vitamins and minerals and trace metals, etc. You know, our body is like a periodic table, right? I mean, and the equilibrium of the body when it's in a state of good health is called homeostasis. And for that to be maintained, you know, simple things like a balance between your sodium and potassium, important. Balance between your calcium and magnesium, important. Now, are they or not? We don't know, right? We eat what we like. We eat when we feel like, etc. So there is the science, underlying science is something that, you know, a layperson doesn't understand. And even in the specialist, different specialists understand it differently, right? And as it pertains to their domain of specialization, if you will, right? So, you know, once you understand these, then you know that, hey, it's not too difficult. If you make a few tweaks, a few changes, like one is if you're healthy and want to remain healthy, what you should do. Second is if your pendulum has swung towards from a state of good health to a state of, you know, not so suboptimal health or disease, if you will, what do you need to do differently to swing the pendulum back, right? And 50 to 60% of that lies in the right nutrition, right? And aligning with what we call a circadian clock, which is at what time do you do what activity, including eating, right? Another 10-15% is in the right fitness routine. Again, you don't need to end up a muscle man or a Mr. Universe, right? There are certain things you need to do, certain kind of muscles called slow twitch muscles, which are very important from a metabolism perspective and to keep that humming, right? So at a minimum, you need to ensure that you activate those and engage those, you know, on a daily basis, right? Another 10-15% is stress, because while we may think stress is in the mind, right, and more emotional, it has a significant physiological impact, right? When we are stressed on an ongoing basis, for whatever reason, it could be around career, it could be around relationship status, money, you know, what have you, traffic that you face, and so on and so forth. But the cascade of hormonal action that happens, starting with the cortisol, ends up in an insulin and raises the level of insulin, which leads to something called insulin resistance, which is at the core of what the umbrella term is something called metabolic syndrome. But the manifestations of that are obesity, PCOS, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease to an extent, fatty liver, you know, kidney disease, what's called neuropathy, retinopathy, you know, Alzheimer's and dementia to an extent, cancer to an extent. All of this end up happening, right, when we have certain kind of metabolic imbalances that exist because of the choices that we make. Sleep, again, I think a lot of us, I mean, and I for sure, all my life used to challenge myself saying that, hey, I need to sleep as little as possible because I want to maximize the rest of the time. And with a little, I'm rested, I have the energy, and it's not a problem. However, now I realize with all my research that sleep is not just about rest. Sleep is also when the maintenance of the body happens, right? So there are bad cells, there are dead cells, they need to be recycled, right? There are metabolites that kind of get produced when you use your brain, right? There's something called tau protein and, you know, beta amyloid that have, you know, gets deposited in the brain. The cleansing of that happens when you sleep. Now, again, imagine this as a city. People use the city in the day and there's a lot of garbage that gets produced. City goes to sleep, let's say around midnight, wakes up at 6. Between this is when the civic authorities come and clean it so that when the citizens wake up, they have a brand new nice city, you know, to live another day. However, if the city went to bed not at 12 but at 2 and it woke up at 4, there is not enough time. The cleaning crew will come, do the best they can, but there is some amount of garbage that remains. Now imagine that happening day in and day out. That pile of garbage only keeps growing. Same thing happens in the body, and this is different kind of garbage, right, probably. But all of them do two things. One, they increase the pace of your aging. And two, they increase your susceptibility to disease, right? So sleep, super important. And again, you know, one minor thing is when you're sleeping, you shouldn't be in a metabolic state, which also means that your last meal should be at least 3 hours before you go to bed, right? Because if your body is in a state of metabolism, your brain believes that, hey, you're still producing energy, so your maintenance activities don't happen. And there's a process called autophagy that needs to kick in, etc. But coming back, you know, to the solution, obviously the enemies here, one is obviously hormonal imbalances in general, but I call it a 3I model. It's insulin resistance, which is one of the key hormones which is not working well. It is inflammation, which is like rusting, which happens within the body, right? And it is like your immunity, which is impaired, right? Your defense mechanisms are weaker. And we have multiple defense mechanisms. We know it commonly as immunity, but there is what's called DNA sanctity. You don't want changes to happen to your DNA, right? The stem cells, which play a critical role in terms of rebuilding in case of some kind of injury. There is your gut microbiome, and I think least understood, but highly impactful and influential. That plays a critical role in the ability of a body to absorb the right nutrients, make it what's called bioavailable, etc. Secondly, super important, and even in keeping our emotionally stable, because there's something called as a gut-brain axis. Now, depending on choices we make, we may not have the right beneficial flora and fauna in our gut, in our intestine. Right. So that again can lead to a problem. So gut microbiome is an important defense mechanism, plays a significant role in immunity as well. But there's something called angiogenesis. Now, all of these may sound like highly technical terms, etc. But I think the solution to avoid all of these, be it your hormonal imbalance or insulin resistance, be it your impaired immunity, and how do you strengthen your defense mechanisms as a whole, how do you ensure there's no chronic inflammation, etc., boils down to simple things. Right, eat right, eat at the right time, right? Don't get stressed, right? Make sure that you sleep well, and make sure that you align to your body's clock, right? Now, I realize that there is a lot of science around it and advice around it, but there's conflicting advice as well. So it's very difficult for people to figure out, is this right, is this wrong? So how do you make those right choices? And then we said, as opposed to advice, we should make it easy to execute. Because the world has moved from what I call, DIY, which is do it yourself, to DIFM, do it for me. How do we make it simple? How do we make it convenient? I have a problem, check in, and we take care of the entire nine yards. And how do we ensure that you become okay? And, so that's essentially what led to, taking all of this cutting edge science that is available out there. And how do you kind of package it into an easily consumable offering for people that want to solve it in a guaranteed manner. And everything is safe, natural. There is, we don't use anything processed. We don't use anything that to a large extent that has chemicals in it. It's all organic, etc. We built the entire supply chain. We built, interesting recipes to make it tasty for people when we deliver the food. We built a cloud ecosystem to be able to make it. We've got a delivery ecosystem to deliver it. We've got, various experts on the same platform, be it your diabetologist or other doctors, your nutritionist, your physiotherapist, your counselors for, stress management, your exercise and yoga, masters, etc. All of that expertise coming together and technology kind of tying all of this. And every aspect of every vector you need to solve it is something that we kind of put together. And we also realized that, for what science understands, before it is available for to common man, it could be decades because there's an entire process. And so the knowledge is not being translated to solutions which are available to help people. Mm-hmm. And, that's why when you take a client-centric or a patient-centric view, when you get all of the science, we said, hey, this is something that we need to take. We need to make it convenient. And, I've obviously overextended the brief of your question and gone into a lot more detail, but that's the story and why we felt it was very important to understand the science and make it available and take a preventive view to this and not make somebody depend on medicines for life. Complications are guaranteed, your risk only keeps increasing. Why can't you kind of swing that pendulum back and get towards the state of good health? Why can't you get off medicine? Like, why can't you reverse some of the problems that you're seeing and get to better health outcomes? And that's right. Essentially the focus of Livolve Life.
Yeah, fascinating. Really, really fascinating. I mean, as someone who has an active interest in health and fitness, I mean, I could actually listen to you for any amount of time, speak about all of this stuff. And my own journey has been over the last 7 years, like really taking control of a lot of these things, right? I mean, so at one point of my time, I weighed about 100 kilos, not very healthy.
Right?
Yeah. not very healthy and you know, wasn't in the best shape, and both physically and mentally, right? And then through variety of interventions, I was able to, you know, not just cut down weight and whatever, but also live a more active lifestyle, live a more intentional, deliberate, purposeful life through these kind of interventions, right? So I perfectly understand what you're talking about. And something I'm really excited about is also, you know, is what you alluded to, which is like this whole consumerization of healthcare, right? I mean, you're seeing that the power is being slowly shifted towards the consumer, basically. It first happened with the internet, with information access, right? I mean, today, I mean, if a doctor gives you a prescription, you have ways and means to sort of like check it with 40 other sources, right? I mean, it happened with access to, let's say, you know, the best healthcare, like, let's say through telemedicine and so on and so forth, right? And what we've seen with COVID and so on.
Yeah.
And, you know, it'll happen with wearables and so on and so forth. How do you see this evolving further, Vivek? I mean, so would it lead to a point where, you know, I mean, I have a gadget measuring everything that you see that in the video games, right? I mean, you have that health indicator and we become something of that sort. I mean, do you see that reaching that point in some time in the future?
No, I think without a doubt. And again, I think it'll, you know, actually go overboard before it comes back to sanity, if you will. But, you know, I think bioinformatics, if you will, or all those sensors or all those measurements play a significant role. That especially if you want to take a preemptive kind of a view, if you want to take a predictive kind of a view, you know, all of this is data that one needs, right? And to an extent, you know, I'll talk about something else that we do, which I didn't cover, and then kind of extend that out to a larger answer.
Yeah. Actually, right? So how do we access LiveAlt Life? You've explained like the broad contours of it, right? Sure. I mean, if I understand correctly, I mean, it's access to the best kind of nutrition advice, best kind of fitness, best kind of everything, right? A very holistic view of what is required for someone. But, you know, how do I access LiveAlt Life? What is LiveAlt Life?
Sure. So I think obviously to understand various ways you can engage with us, the best first place to start would be our website, which is, you know, www.livealtlife.com, LiveAltLife.com, right? That's a great place to start. We also have our number out there and I think, you know, easy to reach us on the phone. Or hello@livealtlife.com is an email. Just anybody can drop us a line. But I think we think of us as, I want to solve a problem. I know it involves multiple, you know, specializations. I know it involves multiple vectors. And I want to do it in an easy, convenient way. I need somebody who's understood the depth of the science and put together a solution where I will submit myself. I will easily take access or take advantage of the solutions and I will see my health become better, right? And I think that's what we are. And it's not, you know, it's not like we're a platform that helps people get connected to multiple solutions. Each of these solution vectors is in-house that we build capability in that we deliver, right?
Okay.
To make sure from a consumer perspective, client perspective, there's a single point and we surround them with all of the solutions that they need to actually, you know, get to better health outcomes, right? And we've seen some amazing stories, Roshan. I mean, we've seen people, and I mean, again, for those of you who may have encountered any of these diseases, which is not too difficult unless you're very young, because, you know, 1 in 5 people has this problem, but it may not be, you know, spoken about. You know, we've taken people from, there's a reading called HbA1c, which is used in diabetes, right, from levels of 12, 13, 14, and brought it within healthy levels of below 6, right, as they go through the program. We've seen people that lose, you know, 15, 20 kgs over a 90-day, you know, program, and it's transformational, right? Mm-hmm. And I define it in two ways, and you've seen it for yourself. You've experienced it yourself. I'm sure you're feeling, significantly better, right? And your outlook to life and purpose and so on and so forth. But one is lifespan, right, which is clearly increased over a period of time. But in that lifespan, there's another thing called health span, which is how long of that lifespan am I healthy? And that, unfortunately, is shrinking, right? While lifespans have increased because of, again, interventions of, you know, newer treatments and medicines and drugs and so on and so forth, health span has not increased. And in fact, it is deteriorating because of the scourge of, you know, lifestyle diseases. And I think one of the things that we do is, how do we increase that health span so that you're healthy for a lot more of the life that you have, and you have a more fulfilling, more purposeful, more meaningful, life that you lead, which is not held ransom to multiple things, right? Which is the regimen of pills before, after, forgetting, you know, and eventually the complications and surgeries, etc. Not needed, right? I mean, live as healthy as you can for as long as you live. And I think that's a journey that we kind of enable, right? So that's, a website probably would be a great first place to start. And, you know, there is combined offerings that people can take, which is an immersive program with multiple vectors. Or there are also what we call unbundled components. Each one can be a separate thing that people can consume. And we see it as a one-time program to swing your pendulum. And then we put you on a path where you can self-manage. And obviously, we are happy to help with different components that we have. You know, and we do workshops to help people cook healthily. We've set up an e-com store because we want to give access to the same high-quality ingredients that we have to our clients to be able to sustain it on an ongoing basis. And we've seen the science work out, proven, you know, seen multiple stories where it's been transformational for them. And it just feels like a good problem to solve when you see people that are able to take advantage of that. Right.
Right. Fascinating. Yeah. So let's talk about some of the nuances of being a healthcare entrepreneur, right? So you've been executing in a different space all along. What is it like solve for healthcare? I mean, you're a tech guy. I mean, you must think, you know, like build, iterate, experiment, and then, you know, learn and go on, right? But those cycles are not necessarily as small in healthcare, right? I mean, because things might take a long time for you to understand whether something's working or not. Sure. So how are you executing rapidly as well as, you know, taking into account some of these nuances?
Sure. And I mean, it's not been unlike drug discovery or creation of a new medicine, which is a different cycle. And that's far more, you know, both resource intensive and time intensive and, you know, proof, etc. That needs to be done and data that needs to be collected. Our approach specifically, you know, at Evolve is a little different. So it doesn't need that level of R&D, but needs significant amount nevertheless, right? And, we have seen startups that launch and in, you know, 6 months have their, pre-Series A and very quickly Series A, et cetera, et cetera. That's something I don't see happen. You know, for us, it's taken us 2 years before we're ready to launch. We've just done a beta launch earlier this year. And we're getting ready around the corner for a formal full-on launch, right, where we take it. And all this while is just to validate and get data to convince yourself that, you know, the hypothesis that you have, the solution that you put in is actually getting the results that you need, right? Because the pilot that proved the science to us was done more than a year back, right? From then on till now is more about ensuring that, you know, every component of the solution, be it the operations, be it the science and how we execute it and the data that we collect, et cetera, is you need to be super sure that it's something that works well, right? And, we've also, you know, going back to your previous question in terms of, I think there was a whole devices and data part of it. So we've also come up with in some way think of it as a health predictor, right? Where we are able to look at certain parameters that are typically not measured, right, by your doctor or your lab, etc., which is more indicative of a future problem, right? If there are metabolism problems that are happening today, right, and you know that you're headed towards a particular destination, so we built we've got one AI solution we built for the nutrition, for what we call precision nutrition, because we need to ensure that all the right amount in the right proportions of nutrients are given to you every day, every week, etc. that, you know, if you cook, I cook, you know, your cook cooks, mom cooks, wife cooks, husband cooks, you can't guarantee. But I think we can, we know that every micronutrient, macronutrient, you know, that is needed, we can go. And so we built a, you know, obviously software that helps us enforce this. Similarly, on the diagnostic side, we built another AI system, which is called, you know, AltLife Diagnostics, AI. There, are we able to tell you that you're on a path that will take you towards diabetes in the next 3 to 5 years, right? And help you take a preventive step now. So we built that out, we built our own model, and we're able to give each of these. But that over time will become super powerful with two things. One is obviously the more clients that we work with and the more data we have is where we'll see patterns that are hitherto not seen, because many of research in this is also a few hundreds and a few thousands. But as we scale this up, we'll have enough data, which I'm sure will show us things that we don't know, right? Correlations that we don't know, causations that we don't know, which will help not just us, but, furthering the science around the whole thing itself. That's one, right? Second is we will be able to, you know, give you early warning signs much before a problem kind of erupts, so that you're able to take a preventive, proactive kind of a step. So, and devices play a critical role there again, like you said. I mean, forget the sci-fi nature, we'll get there as well. But I think there's a lot of data points that we need to collect, right? Be it certain components in your blood, be it certain things, measurements. It could be as simple as your waist, weight. It could be a simple thing as your waist size, right? And what is the trend of it? It could be simple levels of, you know, blood sugar and some of these parameters. But there will be, you know, changes in the way this gets done in an easy way, so that we're able to get all of the data. And, you know, if you look at a self-driving car, if you look at any kind of application of AI, it is based on a lot of data. And I think for you to take a preventive, proactive, or any kind of advanced view on health, you need to collect all of the data. And I think there will be easy ways to get those with, disruptions that will happen in each of these components of the value chain.
Right. So one of the things that we hear in India is that people aren't really interested in preventive health, right? And that the level of healthcare infrastructure and services in India is like, there's just so much scope for improvement, right? I mean, we're talking about a country where we don't have formal electronic health records. We don't have nurses and doctors in the right proportion. We don't have healthcare access, so on and so forth. How are you planning to prioritize preventive health? Because that's essentially what you're trying to do. How do you plan to prioritize this and what is your audience?
So, I think we've evolved over, you know, my lifetime, your lifetime, and over the lifetime of this country as well. And obviously we progressed, right? And I'm sure we'll continue to, right? I'm very hopeful about where we're headed directionally and that we will make the right choices like we've been making over a period of time. Are there problems? Without a doubt. But I see them all as opportunities, because all of the problems and the inefficiencies that we see is an opportunity for us to innovate and solve the problem in a better and leapfrog, right? And I think to that extent, there is, oodles of those all around us, and obviously even in the healthcare ecosystem that we have. And I think we have a lot of strides to take to get to a good place there. So I think, and, you know, being plugged into the startup ecosystem, Roshan, I'm seeing a lot of people look at healthcare, health tech, et cetera, as areas, choosing micro problems and slivers of opportunity and, you know, kind of building an opportunity, be it, you know, innovative devices, be it, you know, low cost ways to assess something, right? Be it the way to connect, you know, providers versus people that need, be it, you know, obviously your health records and digitization of the entire process. And I think, you know, it's very heartening to see the number of entrepreneurs that are, seeing these opportunities and building solutions, et cetera, right? So I'm only hopeful. I do believe that it'll only be better, right, as time passes by, and it will evolve, and we will, you know, end up with given the constraints, a best-in-class solution, right, which is much better than what's available now, including the focus on, you know, telemedicine and healthcare for rural societies that don't have access to best in class, you know, capabilities, etc.
Right.
Specifically in the live-alt-life, you know, case, I think as with anything, we're just going to follow the growth curve, right? Which is essentially there is the early adopters and then the influencers and so on and so forth. So we're super focused on who we believe will be the guys that take a proactive view to this, right? And are there, you know, who are the persona, right, that are more likely to adopt something like this, right? And we know that our society has every type. Our focus is on that micro type. And over time, we do see the acceptance for this becoming larger. And, you know, and there will be a tipping point beyond which, you know, people will say, hey, he's been able to fix it. He's been able to fix it. Why should I bother? And, you know, they've gone to somebody like Alt-Life and that has changed. But we need to get there. We need to earn the right. We need to create those case studies. So for now, we're super focused on what we call our early adopter persona, right? Whose level of motivation is high, whose view on this is future looking and proactive. So that's the subset that we want to build and make enough of those success stories, which will then kind of spread across the larger population of people that need this kind of help.
Right. So one of the aspects of your business is also to work with a lot of these ecosystem stakeholders, right? And, you know, it could be doctors, it could be hospitals, diagnostic centers, so on and so forth. And sometimes you feel that, you know, their interests don't really overlap at some points, you know, I mean, there could be, you know, diverging interests and so on and so forth. How do you kind of, and since you are doing that, how do you kind of bring all of these guys on one platform and, you know, work seamlessly? What's your experience like on that?
So it has been, like you said, you know, there is no, what should I say? There's no convergent behavior. Right? There are different kinds of people playing different kinds of roles. And at the end of the day, they're humans. And every human, the motivation is different, right? And so there are, for example, on the one hand, doctors who say, boss, it's great to see you try to solve this kind of problem. I'll help any way I can, right? Both with advice and talking to my, you know, patients and advising them that do it, etc. To the other hand, where people do ask, what's in it for me? And in a way, you're taking away, you know, my business in a sense. So you have, you know, in every stakeholder, right? I mean, they can take a very myopic kind of a view and what's in it for me kind of view. And there are other people which take a, you know, macro view and saying that, hey, what is the right thing to do? And obviously you align with the ones that align with your view on this. And you hope that slowly you will chip away and convert the other people and they will see, you know, not a narrow here and now short term view, but a larger view and how with patients becoming better, they're doing their job well. If you're able to prevent disease, it's, you know, helping everybody, including the economy, etc. But, you know, the reality is you have every type and you, you know, gravitate more towards the subset that's more aligned. And over time, obviously, we'll be investing ways of engaging with different players in the ecosystem and seeing, you know, how everybody's best interest is a healthier, you know, consumer and how can we work together to make that happen. It may sound utopian, we may never get there, but I think directionally we'll find people that are aligned with that in the journey and, you know, partner with them as we go through this.
Yeah. Just the fact that someone is trying to overlap the interest is itself, I would say, a big positive, because rather than them operating in silos and taking care of their interests first, right? So, you know, we're living in the times of a pandemic, and obviously COVID has changed plenty on multiple spheres, more so on healthcare, right? So how has that affected your plans as such and your outlook for the business, how you want to scale and so on?
Sure. All right. So obviously, I mean, one thing is, as we speak, you know, light at the end of the tunnel is visible, but it still looks like a longish tunnel till, you know, we get to that light. You know, obviously, it's all heartening to see all the chatter of vaccine and, you know, supply chain and how will we crack the distribution, etc. But on the other hand, you also, you know, I'm sure there'll be some scams that will come through. There is the side effects, etc. But hopefully we'll get to the time where we jointly, right, and with the scientists and researchers leading the way, conquer this disease. But that being said, it is, I don't even know how to say it. It's not even a double, triple, quadruple black swan event. It's changed the way we function in the world, right? And, you know, there are so many industries that have got obviously negative, you know, I would say wiped out, right? And, you know, it'll take a while and a significant while for them to recover. On the other hand, obviously, there are many people that have seen significant opportunity, right? And seen their fortunes actually work well as they navigate this. For us, it's been a mixed bag, right? The good part is, I think, two things. One, health has become front and center in everybody's mind, right? Yeah. And everybody realizes the need for, you know, being healthier, you know, having a stronger immunity, et cetera, which is completely aligned with, you know, what it is that we do, for one. Secondly, I think with the entire focus coming on this, they've also realized that specifically the target segment that we go after, you know, their risk is high because, you know, comorbidities actually make it tougher, right, for you to battle COVID, but you to get it, it'll be a little more complex. So, you know, obviously they realize that there is a sense of urgency to solve the problem, which again is a positive thing for us. So that's worked well. I mean, people have shown a lot of, you know, responsiveness and alignment with and resonance with our value proposition and wanting to sign up, et cetera. So I think it's been a good time to talk about a subject that is on top of mind in people's minds, right? So that's worked well. But what's not worked well is two things. One is the uncertainty, right? You know, obviously not now, but sometime back in terms of the supply chain and, you know, with all of the lockdown, the ability to service particular areas and so on and so forth was one problem. The second is obviously the fact that we cook the food and we deliver, you know, is that a higher risk that people undertake? Though obviously we've taken, if N steps are required, probably N squared number of precautions to ensure that it's all safe and hygienic. But that obviously is a more of a headwind where people worry, is it okay? Is it safe? Can I consume? And that's changing. Right? But obviously come May, June, July timeframe, that was probably a concern. So it's been a mixed bag. I think in terms of the larger space and resonance with what we do, I think it's higher now, given that health is front and center in terms of people's priorities. But obviously the COVID scare in terms of minimizing exposure to, you know, anything outside is something that they need to, you know, battle with this as well. Because, you know, if you want to only cook at home, then this won't work, etc. But I think we're coming out of all of that, and I think people are losing up a little, and, you know, we obviously do have our own story of how we tell them why everything is fine and so on. But I think it's been a, you know, at a macro level, it's helped. But obviously there are concerns that we need to kind of deal with as right. we go along, which are again heightened again because of the pandemic.
Right. So how are you thinking about monetization and business models and so on and so forth in so will it be something like a consulting charge, or will that be like a freemium sort of a model on a platform or an app or something of that sort?
No, yeah. So we are going with a, you know, traditional business model where we have a program and we charge significant amount of money for people to do that program and ensuring that we have robust unit economics, etc. from the get-go, right? So that's essentially at least the current thought process in terms of how we want to do it. And right now, we bootstrap. So to an extent, you know, we want to make sure we do get to the business model playing itself out, the unit economics playing itself out, et cetera. And then it's more about scaling it. And we believe that we're solving a big problem, which is a lot of value, right, for the end client. So, you know, there's no freemium and stuff like that.
Okay.
It's all these programs with price points, which we expect people to, you know, pay to take advantage of what it is that we offer.
Right. Okay. Really sorry for the interruption. I'm just going to take a minute to talk about something amazing. Glovo helps your remote teams be more productive by helping them close decisions more faster. I've worked remotely for the last 4 months, and it's just a lot of going back and forth on Slack, on email, on Zoom, etc., but never really getting to a point of execution, right? Well, Glovo makes things a lot more simpler. You can have communication contextually around decisions that you want to make, all you have to do is open a thread on Slack like this and continue to talk about what you want to do with a set agenda. It could be your product roadmap, it could be a marketing campaign, it could be a support ticket, etc. And once you're done, it all syncs with your Slack and you have all of these decisions accessible when you need it, where you need it, right? Guys, I've tried this out and it makes you super productive. If you're even remotely interested, I suggest you go to clergo.com, that's clergo.com, and check it out for yourself. Cheers. Right. Fair enough. You know, before we end the podcast, I'd love for your advice to anyone who's thinking of starting up in the healthcare space.
Right. One, I think context and depth is very important to solve it well. Tech doesn't solve all problems, right? Tech helps you solve the problems well. But I think understanding of the context and, you know, whatever the context is, it's the science and et cetera, very important. Because I think otherwise there's a big disconnect between the not so tech savvy healthcare solution providers and let's say entrepreneurs that want to use tech, etc. If the context is what will kind of get you together, so invest time to understand the problem and go to the depth of it. Right? And don't take I'll throw technology at it and I'll digitize everything kind of a view. Right? That's something that I think is very important if you want to solve a meaningful problem in the space and try to get a medical practitioner as a partner, etc., which will just, get you the frame of reference, the context, the inside workings and so on. So I think that's important. And which second thing is, I think you will see some stuff that will scare you, right? As a consumer of healthcare, be ready for that, right? Like with anything, there are inefficiencies, right? Like with any other space, you will see grayness and you'll need to deal with it be person enough, man enough, or what you call it, what you will, to accept that, it is not perfect and it's okay. And, I will play a role in kind of making it better and not become cynical, right? When you see some of the workings inside. And third, I would say this is more of a positive, I think. There are so many inefficiencies. And like I said, one can crib about it, but I would say it's a sea of opportunity, right? There is so many problems to be solved and it takes all of the people, right? People who understand the human body better, people who understand technology better, people who understand consumer behavior better, etc., to come together, but there's no dearth of problems to make things better. So I think, there are many spaces you could solve problems in, but in healthcare, A, there's an opportunity to solve multiple problems, and B, it is meaningful, right? Because you'll be contributing, in a meaningful way to move humanity forward. So it's a great space to look at.
Right. One final question. Any books or podcasts that you would suggest to our audience?
So, one thing I would say is, I think I find Hidden Brain very useful. Again, so that's a podcast, that's an NPR podcast, I think. It's something that I listen to, which I think is super useful. So that's one thing I would suggest that people listen to, right? Among many others, but that I think if there's one podcast that you should listen to, I think that helps. And, it's not, it's more behavior, it's more people, it's more motivations, etc. But I think it opens up perspectives in your mind that you can apply to any role that you might do, right? Mm. And it looks at problem, different class of problems, which are very interesting, is what I find. So I think Hidden Brain is something that I would urge people to take a listen to, right? In terms of books, again, I think many nice, interesting books out there. But given where we are right now, I think factfulness is something that I suggest, because I think with the amount of information and misinformation that's out there, I think it's very important that each one of us learns a way to discern, what should one consume and not. And I think towards that, that's one good book that I could recommend that people take a look at. I think, you know, otherwise, there are multiple books in the medical realm, but that I'm happy if anybody that listens to it wants to understand more, they can reach out and happy to point them in the right direction.
All right. So Vivek, this was a fantastic chat. Got to learn plenty of things on healthcare, on startups, so on and so forth. Thank you again for spending your time with us, and hopefully we'll talk to you soon.
Absolutely, Roshan. A pleasure talking. Thanks for listening to the story. I can see the genuine enthusiasm given, you know, the interest you have in the space. And happy to have the conversation. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for listening. If you liked this episode, then don't forget to subscribe to us on your favorite platform and share this episode with all of your fellow startup operators. Also, follow the Startup Operator on LinkedIn and Twitter for more updates. Stay safe, take care, and see you soon on a brand new episode of the Startup Operator.